The term scientific romance was one that attached itself in particular to the works of Jules Verne and H.G. Wells, seen by many as the two founding fathers of science fiction. In fact, it is the use of this term that so often leads academics to separate these writers, and even the likes of Mark Twain and Edgar Allan Poe, from the term science fiction. Ask anyone what kind of books Jules Verne and H.G. Wells are notable for, and they will tell you that they were science fiction writers. Verne and later Wells were writing at a time when the advances of science and technology were becoming much more apparent to their respective societies, and their ability to speculate on such advances greatly informed their works, more so than any other writers before them. Jules Verne's output over his long literary career included a number of important science fiction novels, such as Voyage au Centre de la Terre, translated as Journey to the Centre of the Earth, 20,000 lieues sur la mer, translated as 20,000 leagues under the sea, De la Terre à la Lune, translated as From the Earth to the Moon, and its sequel, Autour de la Lune, translated as Around the Moon, to name but a few. Verne's works were often poorly translated into English, but nonetheless, his stories were immensely popular at the time. He is most famous for his tales featuring extraordinary journeys, also known as Voyages Extraordinaires. Although not all of these would fall into the category of science fiction, they are on the whole what we call scientific romances. Verne's particular style within the science fiction tradition was that his novels featured heavily the technologies of his day, and it was with a sense of verisimilitude towards these technologies that herein lay the most notable elements of science fiction in his work. He, however, often failed to complement this with the fantastical lands and beasts that populate his novels. His intent to base his work on sound scientific principles of the time meant that he seldom extrapolated or speculated on these technologies or the science behind them, which coincidentally led him to heavily criticise the works of Wells for that very same reason. I make use of physics. He invents. I go to the moon in a cannonball, discharged from a cannon. Here there is no invention. He goes to Mars in an airship, which he constructs of a material which does away with the law of gravitation. Ah, ça, c'est très joli, cried Monsieur Verne in an animated way. But show me this metal. Let him produce it. It is with H.G. Wells, however, that we can see perhaps the most outstanding contribution and influence to the genre of science fiction, and who is best suited to the title of father of science fiction above the likes of Lucian, Verne, and Gernsback. In fact, Wells's influence on science fiction is probably greater than any other writer, having himself become an oft-used character that appears in many science fiction novels and films. Wells's science fiction is a marked contrast to that of Jules Verne, most notably in the degree to which he is prepared to speculate on both the nature of humanity and its future, and the technological and scientific advances which he extrapolated with remarkable accuracy. Wells's science fiction is an example of first-class prediction using speculation and extrapolation, but this has sometimes mistakenly led it to be seen as prophetic. Within his own lifetime, Wells would come to see many of his predictions and speculations come true, including air-based warfare, the tank, and ultimately the atomic bomb, which he would live to see come into horrifying reality before his death in 1946. His predictions were not just of martial developments, as we see in the shape of things to come, which included ideas such as air conditioning and mass media television broadcasts. The War of the Worlds, published in 1898, based around the concepts of the Thames Valley disaster novels and the plethora of invasion books which were popular in the late 19th century, has become one of the most enduring and adaptable of science fiction works, being continuously remade to suit the times. Wells's take on this style of novel was to make his invaders aliens from Mars, and in an adept stroke, through his interest in the concepts of social Darwinism, actually shows the Martians to be examples of what humanity may become a million or so years down the road. The different versions of War of the Worlds include Orson Welles' Mercury Theatre production in 1938, which became notorious as the broadcast that terrified America, while different movie incarnations have included the George Pal-produced 1953 version, which won an Oscar for special effects, the 1996 film Independence Day, where the virus that destroys the aliens is updated to a computer virus, and the recent Steven Spielberg version in 2005. The 1978 musical version by Jeff Wayne is also currently enjoying a popular resurgence at the moment, and shows both the popularity and adaptability of this work over the last 100 years. Brian Aldiss saw Welles as very much set apart from not only those who came before him, but also those who would come after, and describes his virtues as a writer as follows. The virtues which lift Welles above his successors and above Verne are threefold. Firstly, he inherited something of the inquiring spirit of Swift, and science is, when all said, a matter of inquiry. From this spring the other two virtues, Welles's ability to see clearly the world as it is, for without such an ability it is impossible to visualise any other world very clearly, and his lifelong avoidance of drawing lead characters with whom readers will uncritically identify, and thus be lulled into acceptance of whatever is offered. Darko Suvin sees Welles in a slightly different light, primarily in his attitude to science and technology as a two-edged sword. To Suvin, Welles's main strength was that he was able to look away from the optimistic possible futures of humanity and show that science was indifferent to the needs of mankind, being able to encompass its destruction as well as its salvation. This is very much true of Welles, who could see the myriad possibilities facing humanity as it left the 19th century and emerged into the coming terrors that the first half of the 20th century would provide. Science is the true demonic master of all the sorcerer's apprentices in Welles, who have, like Frankenstein or certain folktale characters, revealed and brought about destructive powers and monsters. From Time Traveller through Moreau and Griffin de Cavour, the prime character of his science fiction is the scientist adventurer as searcher for the new, disregarding common sense and received opinion. Though powerful, since it brings about the future, science is a hard master. Like Moreau, it is indifferent to human suffering. Like the Martians, it explodes the 19th century optimistic pretensions, liberal or socialist, of lording over the universe. In that sense, Welles's The War of the Worlds is also an indictment against the genocidal actions of the British Empire against the people of Tasmania. The helplessness that the locals feel against the invaders was meant to mirror the same helplessness that the Aboriginal people felt against the overwhelming power of the might of Britain. In The Time Machine, an Invention, published in 1895, Welles provides us with two possible outcomes for humanity's evolution, much in the manner of the evolved Martians, and he illustrates these evolutionary possibilities in The Subterranean Morlocks and The Sheep-like Eloi, neither of which would seem particularly appealing in the sense of progress. Welles's novels are now regarded as classics, whether they are of ordinary fiction, scientific romance, or science fiction. His influence on the emerging American magazine market would be enormous, as too were the likes of Verne, Lovecraft, and Poe. But his work also informed the quiet British science fiction tradition, which would carry on throughout the American Golden Age. With his novel The First Men in the Moon, published in 1901, which Verne was so annoyed with, Welles acknowledged the influence of the Lucianic tradition upon his work, doing so by providing the first paragraph of Icaromenippus as an epigraph to this novel. The tradition carried forward from the original Lucianic satire had now reached the 20th century, and whether science fiction or not, had inspired the vast amount of writers who had dabbled in the beginnings of the genre or within the realms of its honourable ancestors. Without Welles, it is unlikely that we would have seen the arrival of such works as Huxley's Brave New World, Yevgeny Zamyatin's We, Olaf Stapleton's Last and First Men and Star Maker, and even Orwell's 1984. But without Lucian, we may never have seen the science fiction works of any of these authors' imaginations, In the wake of Wells and his contemporaries, British science fiction would plod quietly along through the war years, penned by those who were generally not seen as science fiction writers. Rather, they would be viewed as respectable writers, dabbling in this strange fantastical genre. In Britain, science fiction would begin to emerge quietly in the early 50s, before turning against the American tide, which would dominate the genre for over 30 years.